My name is Rachel Powell, and I'm the Women's Sector Lobbyist with the Women's Resource and Development Agency. Happy International Women's Day 2021. What a change from this time last year when we were all rallying on the square together, the last major in-person event that we were able to hold before Northern Ireland went into its first lockdown. And I honestly don't think that any of us could have predicted the year that was to follow. But sure luck, we have adjusted, and I'm so glad that you're able to join us virtually today. Reclaim the Agenda is hosting a whole range of events over the next few weeks, all online, with panel discussions on topics such as the 1921 centenary, developments in the struggle to end violence against women, Black Lives Matter, activist workshops, and much, much more. Today, we're celebrating our interactive online rally, where we are so glad that you've been able to join us in your feminist gear and placards, in your own homes with your families, for today's speakers and entertainment. The theme for International Women's Day 2021 is the new phenomenal. We are here today to celebrate the phenomenal women who make up our society, all contributing to keep our communities going during the new normal over the last year. Danielle Roberts, the co-chair of Reclaim the Agenda, has said, "There has been a lot of talk about the new normal recently, but why should we settle for going back to normal? We have a chance to reshape our society into one that is more equal for everyone, and I couldn't agree with Danielle more. That is exactly why we have chose this theme, the new phenomenal, over the global theme, Choose to Challenge. Because frankly, we all know that women have been challenged enough over the past year, and we want to focus our International Women's Day on celebrating phenomenal women instead. I was very lucky to get to work with so many phenomenal women over the past year, particularly in developing the Women's Policy Group Feminist Recovery Plan. In this, we have provided a comprehensive roadmap on how to change things for the better in Northern Ireland and create a new phenomenal that celebrates and recognises all of the phenomenal women who have rallied during the pandemic, from healthcare and other essential workers to those women who are homeschooling, caring, volunteering, and all of the activists driving change. So on that note, we have some excellent speakers lined up for today's rally. First up, I would like to introduce the Right Honourable Lord Mayor of Belfast, Frank McCoubrey, for some opening remarks.
I'm delighted to be supporting Reclaim the Agenda and the virtual event today to mark the International Women's Day. The new phenomenal is this year's theme, and it is a very fitting one as we celebrate the phenomenal work of women right across the city who have rallied throughout the pandemic to keep our communities going. We have a great lineup of speakers taking part in today's event, and I'm looking forward to hearing from them.
I would now like to introduce Sonya McMullan from the Women's Aid Federation Northern Ireland, a woman that I know has worked tirelessly on campaigning on domestic abuse legislation and so much more over the past year.
Thank you to all the phenomenal women who organise International Women's Day here in Northern Ireland every year, and thank you so much for allowing Women's Aid the time to come and speak today. I'm so sorry we're not at the City Hall together in solidarity, but hopefully next year in 2022 we'll be back together again. This year has been a difficult and challenging one for so many people, and for victims of domestic violence and abuse, it has been extremely difficult. Extremely difficult to access services, extremely difficult to get out of the home. And we have had to adapt our services and Women's Aid to meet the needs of women, children and young people, not only within the community, but also within our refuge and emergency accommodation. We've had to be very innovative, look at all our IT solutions, for example. For an organisation where all of our work is front-facing and face-to-face, we had to really, really adapt, and adapt very, very quickly. The UN launched a report in March of last year calling for all governments to prioritise the needs and safety of women and children. And that was because of the high levels of increase of domestic violence during the pandemic. In Northern Ireland, the same messaging has been coming out as the rest of the UK and indeed the world: stay at home and stay safe. But we know for those people living with an abuser, they're at higher risk, living at the home, and home is not always a safe space. So Women's Aid, through our local Women's Aid groups, we have 8 local groups across the whole of Northern Ireland, and we are open and we are ready to support people. We don't want people to suffer in silence. And what we have really called for is a community and a societal approach. Look out for your friends, neighbours, colleagues, anyone that you think could be at risk. We all have to be really vigilant at this time and try and reach out to those most in need. As I have already said, Women's Aid have had to adapt and be creative in the way that we support, and we continue to do that. We work very closely with voluntary and statutory colleagues to be able to do that. But we also have had a few wins this year in relation to the launch of the Domestic Abuse Bill, or what is now known as the Domestic Abuse and Civil Proceedings Bill. And that, of course, made coercive control an offence. But it was a little bit late, considering this legislation came into place in England in 2015. So we do welcome it, but there were a lot of things within the bill that we didn't get. We didn't get a domestic abuse commissioner. We didn't get a review of our family courts. We didn't get a gender definition of domestic abuse, and we didn't get a violence against women and girls strategy. So we are calling on all of you. We are calling on everyone to follow our social media campaigns in the coming weeks, where we are launching a petition in relation to Northern Ireland being the only part of the UK, again, that doesn't have a violence against women and girls strategy. And we would encourage all of you to please participate and help us lobby local government to recognise the gendered nature of these crimes. On the 25th of November, we launched our Unlock Your Lockdown campaign here across the whole of Northern Ireland. And it was a campaign really targeting those who haven't reached out for support during this current lockdown. And we really want to promote the services of Women's Aid to get in touch and don't suffer in silence.
Thank you so much for that, Sonya. The work from you and your colleagues in Women's Aid has been absolutely crucial in protecting women from domestic abuse in Northern Ireland. I would now like to introduce Coumilah Manjoo from the Belfast Multicultural Association.
Growing up in a multicultural country, I never considered myself to be a minority, or felt that there is anything I could not do or could not achieve. Being in Northern Ireland, I have faced my fair share of racism and racist abuse. I have faced discrimination due to my female identity also. I notice that these forms of oppression come together in many instances. Despite this, I've always had big aspirations and been very ambitious. I will always remember when I was younger, I used to question everything, and my family made me feel there is nothing I could not do. However, in Northern Ireland, there has been instances where I have had people in public spaces question what I wanted to do, who I wanted to be. The reason I am here today is I want to challenge the notion that BME women are vulnerable. BME women are not vulnerable. They are phenomenal. Saying minoritized people are vulnerable infers some kind of inherent weakness or defect. The word shifts the blame to the minoritized individual, as opposed to rightfully placing the blame on oppressive system. I am here because I need BME women and girls to understand it is possible for them to have high aspirations and achieve their ambitions. I need them to know the importance of raising issues within communities and putting themselves in places of representation. I want to encourage women to be courageous and be present in all spaces, civic and public, where there is a lack of representation. Otherwise, nothing will change. We need to be in every aspect of the community. We need to be seen, and we need to be really asking those questions and putting ourselves forward in the political arena. That's the only way we can make a change. I mean, when you think about women of color in history, what did they fight? We're fighting the same fight, except this time it's slightly different. Racism and sexism combine to shortchange BMA women as they experience multiple forms of oppression. The strict categories of racism and sexism are too broad and do not allow consideration for how these forms of discrimination intersect and frequently interact, coming hand in hand, amplifying inequalities experienced by BMA women. A number of BMA women in Northern Ireland do not have the opportunity to develop leadership skills for several reasons, including family responsibilities, lack of knowledge about available opportunities, and language barriers, all of which disadvantage BMA women. While there has been some progress in recent decades, there's still plenty more that needs to be done to tackle racist and sexist-based discrimination within Northern Irish society and institution, both of which continue to limit BMA women. Looking back on my work with BMCA, it reminds me of how women are the backbone of the community sector. I reflect on the work that we have done in the past year, the food bank, the comfort pack, the financial support, supporting homeless shelters, the clothes bank. Our work speaks for what we represent. We represent an intercultural society. Multiculturalism is the coexistence of diverse cultures, where culture includes racial, religious, or cultural groups. What we want is a shared and safe community, one which moves away from relationships that are built on mistrust and defense up to relationships rooted in mutual recognition and trust. We need to move away from a society where inequality is entrenched. Social justice, compassion, and empathy need to triumph and give us a glimpse of the society we want to live in and the society we want our children and next generations to inherit. Change can happen. What we need is action. We need to remember that darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that. BMCA have been extremely grateful for the support we have witnessed. It gives us hope for the future, a shared future, knowing that we belong and we have a place in this community.
Thank you so much for that, Coumilah. The work you have done over the past year has been inspiring, especially as you have had to face so many challenges, including the horrific hate crimes against the Belfast Multicultural Association. You are phenomenal. I would now like to introduce Deborah Yapicioz, the co-chair of the Unison Regional Women's Committee.
Hello, sisters. My name is Deborah Yapicioz, and I'm a proud trade union activist and one of the joint chairs of the Unison Regional Women's Committee. I was delighted to be asked to speak today on International Women's Day on behalf of those women who work in the health and social care service in Northern Ireland. I think we can agree that 2020 was a year like no other for all of us. And it has been a particularly rocky time for women who are on the front line of our health and social care service, keeping us safe through the COVID pandemic and stepping up to the plate without hesitation. Not to mention the thousands of other roles that women in Northern Ireland carry out in all areas such as retail that have kept our country running over the last year. At the beginning of 2020, staff in the health service had just returned to work after strike action, which had highlighted the fact that National Health Service workers in Northern Ireland were the lowest paid in the UK. We had also brought our real concerns about safe staffing into the public arena. Our communities were very supportive of the action that staff in the health service took, which ultimately led to the return of the Northern Ireland executive. Just a few short weeks later, we all watched in horror as the coronavirus made its way to our shores, changing our lives in a way that we never thought possible, plunging us into the unknown. The NHS, remember, was already understaffed and underfunded long before the pandemic hit. COVID-19 pushed the system to breaking point, forcing trusts across Northern Ireland to suspend elective operations and delay appointments. Three quarters of our NHS is staffed by women, and we make up the majority of care workers in the independent sector. So it was overwhelmingly women on the front line of the pandemic from the start, working in a health service ill-prepared for the battle we were faced with. Right from the start, PPE, the protective clothing that is the barrier between nursing and care staff and patients with COVID, was not fit for purpose because it was originally designed for Caucasian males. We also were not equipped with enough of it right at the start. COVID has meant that many women in all jobs ended up juggling work, homeschooling and caring responsibilities. Schools, nursery closures and the shielding of family members who supported women with childcare brought stark choices between paid work and care commitments, and also presented challenges as women were faced with difficult choices. Many of our members report having to use annual leave and even unpaid leave to cover childcare. Many of our female healthcare members chose to move out of their family homes in an attempt to balance the safety of their children and vulnerable family members with their work responsibilities. The coronavirus pandemic has brought all of these issues into the public arena in a very dramatic way. It has come as no surprise to the Unison Women's Committee that one of the front lines in the early days of the COVID-19 pandemic was being fought by our members on the battlegrounds of the private, residential and nursing home sector. Care staff in this area literally put their lives on the line as they cared for our most vulnerable citizens, often with minimum staffing and without the PPE, which is seen as essential for employees and residents to stop the spread of the virus. This is further compounded by the fact that despite the tremendous skill and accountability of their roles in private home care settings, frontline workers are almost exclusively on or very near minimum wage salaries. Workers in care homes right in the front line of COVID-19 were also left to exist on statutory sick pay when they became ill. Thankfully, this is a battle that Unison has been able to help many of our members with. It doesn't have to be like this. A decent wage for those in the NHS and the care sector, stronger employment rights in the independent care sector with greater flexibility and a decent childcare system would help us all to better balance our lives, whatever the circumstances. And change is imperative if we want to kickstart our economy after this crisis. The COVID vaccine could very well be the light at the end of the coronavirus tunnel. As we approach the end of the third surge of the pandemic and reflect on the last year, it is acknowledged that many of our members are exhausted and will need time to recover both mentally and physically in the aftermath of the pandemic. Women have always done incredible things, and they've done it for a really long time. And we will continue to fight for change. For all those phenomenal women on International Women's Day, let's choose to challenge the burdens that fall so excessively on all working women and carry on fighting for a better system for everyone. Thank you, and you enjoy your day.
Thank you so much for that, Deborah. Women have been particularly challenged economically and are overrepresented in part-time, low-paid and precarious work. We need the trade union movement with us now more than ever. I would now like to introduce Nancy Wallach, Board of Governors of ALBA, the Abraham Lincoln Brigade Archive.
Hello, my name is Nancy Wallach. I'd like to thank Reclaim the Agenda for inviting me to share my vision along with this group of phenomenal women on the program today. It's this kind of camaraderie that gives us the boost and the support to keep working for the kind of future we all deserve. I'll never forget the power of the Women's March in 2017, when on the day after the Trump inauguration, over 5 million people around the world gave us the inspiration to keep on fighting. As we let the world know that women's rights are human rights and that Trump is not my president, I remember the turnout in New York City being so large, the event being so packed that I literally could not move, not even a few streets over, in order to connect with my friends. And I remember being elated because the phenomena of that physical inability to move in the midst of that sea of men, women, and children moved my spirit and moved me to keep on resisting, to keep on working for a world that would protect a woman's right to choose, a world that would protect a woman's right to join a union, to be free from the danger of mass shootings, and to have access to paid childcare and family leave. I first visited Belfast in 2014, about a month earlier than International Women's Day, when I spoke at an International Brigade Commemoration Committee event to honor the anti-fascists who had set an example of unity and internationalism when fascism first threatened the world in Spain in 1936. Who would have thought that in 2021, we'd be facing down an internal fascist threat led by our then president of the United States of America, and that we would experience a violent attempt overturn our newly elected government, and that some of our representatives in government would aid and abet the attempted coup. Even as we gather here, the Republican Party is renewing an all-out effort to suppress voting rights in 28 states. How do we answer those who claim that votes only count when a Republican wins? How do we respond to those who try to forcefully throw out the votes of minorities, of women, and of people of color? Here are the stories of a few women whose answer to these threats was to keep on organizing with determination and courage. One such person is Stacey Abrams. In the same way that we showed up in millions for the Worldwide Women's March after the Electoral College imposed Trump on us, so Stacey Abrams chose to move forward after her own close gubernatorial election defeat. Her defeat was the true stolen election. Brian Kemp, her Republican opponent, used his office as Georgia Secretary of State to oversee the racially motivated purge of more than 85,000 votes from the rolls. That setback only inspired her to move forward. Abrams channeled her energy and activism into founding Fight for a Fair Vote in Georgia, which brought about a massive voter registration effort. She worked also to challenge the forced pregnancy bill enacted by Kemp. As the 2020 election drew near, this mission evolved into building grassroots teams across the country to protect the vote. It helped produce the 7 million vote margin that has created a mandate for progressive change. Thanks to Fair Fight's efforts, the first Jewish and the first African-American senators from Georgia were elected, putting an end to the Republican Party's stranglehold on national legislation. She helped us all answer the threat of fascism by kicking Trump out of the White House and Mitch McConnell out of leadership in the Senate. But Stacey Abrams said in her official State of the Union rebuttal to Donald Trump, "We do not succeed alone." Abrams and the grassroots activists of Fair Fight did not do it alone. 90% of Black women, more than any other demographic, voted Democratic in the last election. They were also not alone because they were connected to a long tradition of activism led by Black women and also by pioneering Irish American women such as Mother Jones and Elizabeth Gurley Flynn. Today, I would like to acknowledge the work of two phenomenal women of color who helped lay the foundation for Stacey Abrams' work and for the victory for democracy that we are able to celebrate today. The abolitionist Sojourner Truth, who was born into slavery, represented Black women at the first National Women's Rights Convention in 1850 in Worcester, Massachusetts. The following year, in her famous "Ain't I a Woman" speech, she laid out the core argument that fueled voting rights activism for decades, that equal access to the ballot is a matter of human rights. Sojourner Truth fought for freedom and abolition at the same time as she fought for women's rights. She saw their interconnectedness in her own and in all of our lives. In the 1960s, Fannie Lou Hamer, a sharecropper from Mississippi, embodied that same intersection of workers, women's, and minority rights. She lost her job in her initial attempt to vote, but she didn't let that stop her. Once she became aware of her constitutional rights, she not only wanted to use them herself, but even more, she wanted to ensure that others would also benefit. She became a field organizer for SNCC, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, and later co-founded the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party. She crisscrossed the country, speaking to Black farm workers about the importance of voting, and like her peer, John Lewis, she was brutally beaten after she led a sit-down in South Carolina. Hamer played a large role in helping to bring about the historic Voting Rights Act of 1965. The work of these women who paved the way for today's activists impacted people of all races and genders. Their dedication to moving forward is another thing they share with Stacey Abrams and with all of us who keep on keeping on in the work that lies ahead of us.
Thank you so much for that, Nancy. It is inspiring to hear the work that you have been doing, and it is crucial that we continue to challenge far-right political extremism. I would now like to introduce Naomi Sloan, student at University of Ulster, an executive member of the Northern Ireland Youth Forum.
Hello, my name's Naomi and I am honoured to speak at this year's International Women's Day event. As strong women, we have achieved many things such as the right to vote, greater employment opportunities and challenged perceptions of what women can do. However, we still have a long way to go. As women, we are viewed as weak. This is especially true for young women with disabilities. As a young woman with a disability, I have been talked down to, verbally abused, and have been seen as a burden on society. In education, teachers set low expectations of what I could achieve. When I asked for specific adjustments to be made, I was made to feel like an inconvenience or a burden to the classroom. If my classroom assistant was sick, I was sent home and was not allowed to attend school. As a result, I was denied my right to education. This is an ongoing issue for young people with disabilities. I am currently studying community youth work at Jordanstown University, and only this week did I receive the correct equipment that I am entitled to enable me to study. This is a full semester complete without my specific equipment and software. Despite this, I am determined to succeed. I am a proud member of the Northern Ireland Youth Forum and sit on the executive committee. I also take part in a group called Face to Face for Young Disabled Leaders. I want to be a role model for other young disabled women to show they have power and a voice. So I am making the change I want to see in the world. Today I am calling for you to support the face-to-face group in our campaign asks. Ask one, I want young people with disabilities to have all the support they are entitled to before they start school or tech. This can include equipment, transport, or emotional support. Ask two was that everyone who interacts with young people with disabilities have access to disability awareness training, which respects our right to speak and make decisions for ourselves. And the final ask is that society adopts a model of disability where the society's makeup is seen as the problem and not the person with the disability. Finally, I will say that I identify as a disabled woman has made me stronger. I will stand and fight for what is right and just. I want to add my voice to the call for free sanitary products for women, not just in Northern Ireland, but across the world. I choose to challenge this discrimination. In the words of Judy Heumann, change never happens at the pace we think it should. It happens over years of people joining together, strategizing, sharing, and pulling all the levers they possibly can. Gradually, exclusively, slowly, things will start to happen, and then suddenly, seemingly out of the blue, things will tip. Let today be the tip onwards to our rights.
Thank you so much for that, Naomi. Young people have been so disproportionately impacted by the global pandemic, and it is absolutely crucial that young women's voices are included. Finally, I would like to introduce Hasna Elsiyofi, founder and member of the Sudanese Community Association.
My name is Hasna Elsiyofi. Originally, I'm from Sudan. I have been here in Belfast for the last 5 years. I came to join my husband, and back home, I was working in international organization in human rights, women rights, and issue affecting war victim. When I came to Belfast, first of all, I would like to congratulate all women on International Women's Day. And I want to reassure all the women that I stand in solidarity with all women who are facing difficulty, facing violence in workplace and in institution at home. And I stand in solidarity with women whom are really affected by war. And I pledge to work to end racism, sexism, and congratulations for International Women's Day. When I came to Belfast, I decided that I find it is like difficult, and it is hard to come to a country where the language is one of the biggest barriers facing each other. But because I believe in diversity, and I believe in participation, and I believe in human rights and women rights, I bring all the women whom feel they are vulnerable. We come together and we establish a group of women called, we call it Flowers of Belfast, Zahrat Belfast. And from here, I congratulate all the Sudanese women whom in my group, and we come together, we put hands together because we are in foreign country, beautiful country, but foreign for us because the language, as I said, is a barrier. And we decide to stand to each other, help each other, trying to understand the law here, trying to be integrated in the community, and to build relation, and to focus on our well-being, and to engage in the community. It was hard because to bring people together and to let them build their own capacity and to empower them, it was really hard. It was not led by me, but it led by all women whom are in the group. And we are trying to be part and parcel from the community. And we were, I think to some extent we are successful. and we take all the opportunity and we try to be empowered and we work hard and we inspire by our success and by the women who are here are take us to the longer way. And we try as much as we can to be part from all the project and all the event whom taking place for women. And we start the first thing to get our English lesson, which it was the successful steps for all of us. And we are inspired by the great women whom are leading the revolution in Sudan, and we are proud of them. And we came from a community that everything are led by men, but we tried as much as we can to be there, our voice being heard, and we are trying to find our places as women and to use the knowledge. And in my opinion, the key word is in our work together is the knowledge, to know the community which we are being in, and to benefit from all the opportunities, and to participate in the strategic action whom which is concern us, which is be a key point for all of us, and it we reflect that in our participation, in our attending the different event. And a long way, there is myself, I inspired by women, great women in my country, whom are leading the revolution. And it was last 2 years, and there is globalization. There is women whom are wearing the white top. The top is the sari, which Sudanese women are wearing it. And it went globally, and we are proud of the lady whom are representing the woman, and it shows how much solidarity all the Sudanese women shown. And we have great women, and this is remind me with my mom, whom was a teacher, and whom shaped me and support me. And I learned from her that the key point to be empowered is education. And she let me think out of the box, and she shaped me, and she was a strong woman. And she's always, she was telling me that to think out of the box and to provide help to women in different circumstances, and to be without her, I would not be Hasna Elsiyofi, and she shaped me, and I miss her. And my mom, her name was Saadia Abdurrahman, and again I congratulate all women, and happy International Women's Day. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that, Hansa. It is incredible the work you have been doing, and it is inspiring to hear the work of the Sudanese Community Association.
Hi everyone, my name is Emer Maguire, and I'm delighted to have been asked to give you a message for International Women's Day here in Northern Ireland. So I know Northern Ireland is celebrating the new phenomenal, which is just a brilliant team. So we're looking at phenomenal women who have impacted us, particularly over the last year. So I want to take a minute to appreciate all those wonderful people, all of the wonderful women who've really, really rallied during the pandemic. So obviously healthcare staff, like my partner, my previous colleagues, and the majority of my friends who've done their best to keep us healthy during this really, really scary and weird time. but I'm also thinking about people who have been doing crazy homeschooling schedules, to all the essential workers, those who are working in shops, who have kept us moving, who have pulled everybody through this, basically. And I really want to say a big thank you to all the artists and the creatives as well, who were sometimes forgotten, but obviously kept us really entertained and kept our brains stimulated with all things beautiful all through the pandemic. So to all of the brilliant women, thank you so much. I couldn't kind of talk about the new phenomenal without mentioning those of you who have pulled us through. So we need to continue to drive change within our community. We need to continue to celebrate and platform women. We need to continue to make our voices heard, and we need to continue to kind of amplify the voices of those who feel silenced or quieted. And I know a lot of people who are watching or listening won't know me. So I'm a musical comedian, an event host, a radio presenter, a science communicator, basically all things that my parents say are real jobs. And usually in those roles, I'm very much in the minority by virtue of being a woman. And actually a month ago, I left my career in speech and language therapy to pursue my more creative career. And the bizarre thing is, as a speech and language therapist, all of my colleagues were women. I didn't have a single male colleague. It's almost an exclusively female profession. So I've gone from a profession that's solely, you know, women colleagues to work with almost all men, which is quite strange for me. But in the more creative pursuits that I have, I really wanted to take up my place in these spaces, and I wanted to be phenomenal, and I wanted to show how brilliant and bright and worthy women are, because to me, I just know that to be true. I just know it as a fact. And I wanted to be visible as a woman, kind of in those fields of comedy and in science communicating and in presenting, so that other women and girls can see me and say, hey, that's cool, that's someone who looks like me, I want to be like her, I want to be like that. So they've basically kind of got a role model to identify with. And I wanted to dispel a few of the myths as well that go along with my chosen career path. So I wanted to dispel that myth that all great comedians are men. I wanted to dispel that kind of societal construct that science is for boys, and dispel that myth that the person who's in charge at an event or the person commanding the room is a man. And I want everyone, kind of regardless of who they are, to have equal footing. So I want us all to really push ourselves forward together, and kind of I want to kind of have a bit of a call to action for people to call out gender bias, no matter who you are, call out inequality, and make equality and equality for women the norm. And let's platform each other. Let's kind of celebrate all the phenomenal women that we know. So let's celebrate ourselves. And I want to say a really big happy International Women's Day to everyone. Thank you.
What an amazing bunch of speakers that we had today. Thank you so much to all of you for sharing your experiences with us and for the work that all of you have been doing. You truly are phenomenal women. That's all from me, folks. I'd like to say again, happy International Women's Day 2021. And here is to the phenomenal women upholding our society. If you're tweeting today, please use hashtag the new phenomenal, hashtag IWDNI21, and hashtag phenomenal women. And you can see the rest of our events on Reclaim the Agenda's website. Thank you.